Okay. So this is the third in a four-part series on pseudorandomness and graphs. Yesterday we talked about Samurai's regularity lemma, and we mentioned a few applications in graph theory and in number theory. Today I want to focus on some algorithmic applications and discuss whether or not the regularity method is really necessary toward the end. Okay, so just as a quick recollection from yesterday, there's this notion of irregularity in a graph, or rather between two vertex subsets of a graph, and it measures how uniform the edges are between the two vertex subsets. If it's small, then the graph is between them is very pseudorandom. If it's large, it's not. And there's this notion of irregularity of a partition, where you sum up the irregularity over all pairs of parts in your partition. And if that's small, then you can think of your graph partition as being regular, epsilon regular, if it's at most this particular value. And Samurai's celebrated regularity lemma says that for every epsilon greater than zero, there's an M of epsilon, so that every graph has an epsilon regular vertex partition with at most M of epsilon parts. So this is just a recollection from yesterday. And we also proved yesterday one of the nice applications, which is the triangle removal lemma. And it tells you if a graph has few triangles, then you can remove few edges from it and get rid of all the triangles. The proof we gave yesterday of the triangle removal lemma, all of the parts of that generalize into a graph removal lemma. So if you're given any graph H and an epsilon greater than zero, there's a delta greater than zero such that any graph with few copies of H in it can be made H-free by removing a small number of edges. Now, so this is mostly recollection from yesterday. Now I want to start going into some algorithmic applications. Traditionally, in computer science, an algorithm that runs in time polynomial in the input size was considered fast. Now, as the data sets have gotten enormous over time, this is often now thought of as insufficient. And with these enormous data sets, you would like not to even have to look at the whole thing. And sometimes you don't even understand the whole data set. For example, the internet. I don't think any individual has a good understanding of the entire internet. And yet you can model it as a network, and you'd like to understand properties of it in order to run algorithms. So the goal of property testing is you'd like not to say everything about what you're looking at, but just say something. So the goal of property testing is to quickly distinguish between objects that have a property from objects that are far from having the property. So if I gave you an enormous graph and I wanted you to quickly tell me whether or not there's a triangle on the graph, and you weren't allowed to look at the whole graph, well, this is an impossible task. But maybe it's possible to distinguish between an object that's a graph that's triangle-free from an object that's far from triangle-free, that you'd have to delete an epsilon n squared edges to make it triangle-free. So this has become a big area in computer science. It was originally introduced by Rubenfeld and Sudan in 1996, and since invested for combinatorial properties by Goldreich, Goldwasser, and Ron. In particular, graph property testing has received a lot of attention. And a graph property P is testable if for each epsilon greater than zero, there's a randomized algorithm, which in constant time, so this is allowed to depend on epsilon and the property P you're given, but doesn't depend on the input size of the structure, the graph you're looking at, distinguishes with probability at least 2/3 between graphs having the property p and graphs which are epsilon far from having p. Then the question is, which graph properties are testable, and can you have this dependence on epsilon and p be rather small? So as a nice application of the triangle removal lemma, you can show that triangle freeness is testable. So you want to distinguish between graphs that are triangle free from graphs which are where you have to delete at least epsilon n squared edges to make it triangle free. So what is the proof? We're going to pick 1 over delta random triples of vertices. And delta here is from the triangle removal lemma. So it's the same exact delta from the triangle removal lemma. So we have this huge graph. We're not actually looking at the whole graph. We're just going to sample 1 over delta random triples of vertices. And the algorithm will accept if no triple of vertices we query make a triangle. Otherwise, we'll reject. So if your input graph was triangle free, none of these triples you'll see will make a triangle, and your algorithm will accept. What if your graph is epsilon far from being triangle free? That means you need to delete at least epsilon n squared edges to delete all triangles. Well, then by the triangle removal lemma, you know your graph has at least delta n cubed triangles. So when you look at a particular triple, the probability that it is not a triangle is at most 1 minus 6 delta. And you sample these triples uniformly and independently at random. So because of the independence, when you've sampled 1 over delta of them, you raise this to the 1 over delta power. For the acceptance probability, and simple analysis shows that that's less than 0.01. So the probability, if you were epsilon far from being triangle free, that this algorithm accepts is at most 1%, or less than 1%. So you'll you'll very likely reject in that case. So this connects up this notion of this triangle removal lemma, or removal lemmas in general, with property testing. In the same exact way, testing H-freeness of a graph is, H-freeness is testable, and by essentially the same algorithm. Testing induced H-freeness turned out to be a lot harder. And this was essentially shown by a result of Alon, Fisher, Krevelevich, and Segedy. So they had to prove an induced graph removal lemma. And we'll discuss that shortly. So what's an induced subgraph? So if H is the 5 cycle, this is the graph on 5 vertices. And you would like to, when you say epsilon far, now you're allowed to add or delete edges. So it's just close. And induced, having an induced C5 is saying you have 5 vertices in your graph. All the edges that are supposed to be there are there. They make a 5 cycle, and the non-edges should not be there. So when you usually talk about subgraph, you don't worry about whether or not the non-edges are there or not. But for induced subgraphs, the non-edges should not be there. So this turned out to be harder. And in order to do this, you can try using the regularity lemma to prove the induced graph removal lemma. And it turns out that becomes a serious problem because of irregular pairs. And we'll discuss this a little bit more shortly. But what they ended up doing is developing something called a strong regularity lemma. And that's proved by iterating Samarity's regularity lemma. Instead of getting tower type bounds, you end up getting Wowser type bounds, which is next up in the Ackermann hierarchy. And so you have this strong regularity lemma, which we'll go into shortly. And using that, you can get an induced graph removal lemma and show that induced H-freeness is testable. Later on, Alon and Shapira showed that every hereditary graph property is testable. So what is a graph property in general? It's just a family of graphs. And a graph property is hereditary if it's closed under induced subgraphs. So if you have a graph in your family, then whenever you look at an induced subgraph of it, it's also in your family. And these are essentially the natural properties that you come across when you're working on things in graph theory. So this is a very general result, and it's equivalent to an infinite removal lemma. So for an infinite family of graphs, you can have a removal lemma. And again, you use the strong regularity lemmas and some additional ideas to prove that. So I next want to discuss the induced graph removal lemma and the strong regularity lemma. Is there any questions about this so far? Okay, so the induced graph removal lemma says that if you're given an epsilon greater than 0 and a graph H on little h vertices, there's going to be a delta greater than 0 such that if you have a graph with few induced copies of H, so at most delta n to the h induced copies of H, you can make it induced H-free by adding or removing epsilon n squared edges. And here you really do need to add or remove. You can't just remove epsilon n squared edges for this to be true in general. And as I mentioned, the proof develops a strong regularity lemma, which is proved by repeated use of Semre's regularity lemma and gives a Wouser type bound. And formally, the Wouser function W of n is defined by W of 1 is 2, and then W of n is applying the tower function to W of n minus 1. These are very fast-growing functions. So Nogo alone asked to estimate the dependence of delta on epsilon in the induced graph removal lemma. And one natural approach to this would be to try to show that the strong regularity lemma could be proved with a better bound. So you have this enormous upper bound. Maybe there's a better way to prove the strong regularity lemma. So what is the strong regularity lemma? Instead of getting one partition of your vertex set, it gives you two partitions. And they have a certain property between them. So if you're given an epsilon greater than 0 and a function f from the positive integers to 0, 1, there's going to be an m which depends on epsilon and f such that the following holds. Every graph has an equitable vertex partition, p. Now, p is just like in the regularity lemma. It's epsilon regular. So that's what you're looking for in the regularity lemma. And an equitable refinement q into at most big M parts satisfying p is epsilon regular. Q is much more regular. Its regularity is allowed to depend on the size of p. And yet, the mean square density between the mean square density of the partition q is close to the mean square density of the partition p. And what that is essentially equivalent to is a saying that, so if we have our partition p, here's V1 to Vk. And now this is our partition P. Now we cut it up further to get a refinement. And that's our partition Q. This property that the mean square density of Q is close to the mean square density of P, because Q is a refinement, this mean square density is at least the mean square density of P. So Q of Q is at least Q of P. But it's not much larger than the mean square density of p. This is equivalent to telling you that for almost all pairs of parts in q, if you look at the density, so here's a x and a y, and this is a vi and a vj, where x is in vi and y is in vj. So for almost all x and y in Q, the density between X and Y differs from the density between Vi and Vj, the parts that they come from, by at most epsilon. And this is changing epsilon here by a polynomial amount. But it's saying that basically these small pairs, their densities are typically close to the densities between the parts that they lie in. Okay. Yes?
Each part is also a fraction to m parts, di's?
So the total number of parts in Q is at most m. So if you add up all these little parts, the total number of them is m. And these are equitable partitions, so they essentially have the same size. So why come up with this? I mean, the naive approach is to just apply the regularity lemma to prove the induced graph removal lemma. And so if you applied the usual regularity lemma, you'd get this regular partition. And between some parts, the density will be close to zero. So it'll be very sparse. And then for those, you'll just delete the edges between them. And for some pairs of parts, the density between them will be close to one. You'll add some small number of edges between them. There'll be other pairs whose density is bounded away from 0 and 1. And they'll be regular. And there, you don't have to do anything. Now, there's these last type of pairs where they're irregular. And there, you don't know what to do. They actually don't do much. There's not so many pairs like that. But they're enough to cause you problems. You don't know whether to add or remove edges there. And the irregular pairs become a serious problem. And because of that, they developed this strong regularity lemma in order to get around this issue of irregular pairs. So we saw last time that irregular pairs are necessary, that you can't get around not having them. But with a strong regularity lemma, there's a way around it. So that's why they developed the strong regularity lemma. And so this tool has been very useful in graph property testing. And its proof is by repeated application of Samarit's regularity lemma. So why is that? Well, you'll start off and you'll find a vertex partition that's equitable P1, which is epsilon regular. And that's just by applying Samarit's regularity lemma. Now, you'll apply Samarit's regularity lemma again to get a partition which is f of the size of P1 regular. And you'll call that partition P2. And you keep doing, so if Q of P2, if the mean square density of P2 is at most the mean square density of P1 plus epsilon, then you're done. P1 would be your P and P2 would be your Q. Otherwise, the mean square density of P2 is more than epsilon larger than the mean square density of P1. In which case, you would refine P2 further and you get a P3, which is f of P3 regular. And there's one small caveat. You can assume that f is always at most epsilon, so that you can guarantee that these are all at most epsilon. If P3 has that the mean square density is at most the mean square density of P2 plus epsilon, then you'd be done. You'd let P2 be your P, and you'd let your Q be P3. And so you continue. But you can only continue for at most 1 over epsilon steps, because each time your mean square density is going up by epsilon. And it's the mean square density is between 0 and 1. And therefore, you must have stopped at some point, and you arrive at this strong regular pair of partitions. Is there any questions about this? Yes?
Explain how do you get around these epsilon fractions?
Yeah, so I'll explain that shortly. I'll mention one of the corollaries that's enough to get this. And then, so we'll explain that shortly, how you get that, yeah. So this approach, in terms of using the strong regularity lemma, it turns out you need the Wouser-type bounds in the strong regularity lemma. So it doesn't say anything about the induced graph removal lemma. So a result of David Conlin and myself shows that a Wouser in polynomial and 1 over epsilon bound is necessary. So we came up with a construction which basically matches what you're doing in this proof and shows that you need to do this for the strong regularity lemma. So these horrible bounds are really necessary in the strong regularity lemma, and it shows that that this is really the right proof for it. Around the same time, Kalyan Sundaram and Shapira independently also gave a Wowser type bound. Their bound was a bit weaker, but they kind of did things a little bit differently. But there's two proofs showing that Wowser that came out that are necessary. Okay, so in the strong regularity lemma, we're not going to hope for a better bound. However, the strong regularity lemma has a nice corollary that's enough for property testing. And this corollary says that there's going to be a vertex partition of your graph. It's equitable. So here you have this vertex partition of your graph, v1, v2, vk. And inside each of your subsets, there's going to be a large subset. Inside each vi, there's going to be a large subset ui with the following properties. So each of the uis is large. It's at least delta times the total number of vertices. So these are big subsets of your graph. And every pair ui, uj is epsilon regular. So the vi, vj's, we don't know if they're regular or not. But these little subsets, between them, they're regular. They're further even regular with themselves. So ui turns out to be regular with themselves. And the following holds. So for almost all your pairs, ui, I and j, the density between ui and uj differs from the density between vi and vj by at most epsilon. Now, how do you deduce this from the strong regularity lemma? Well, these UIs, you apply the strong regularity lemma. The VIs make this partition P. You take a random, if you pick F appropriately, you just take a random subset from your partition Q from each of the parts. So a random part from each of the parts, and it'll almost surely have this property. So most choices of U1 to UK will work if you pick things appropriately. So that's how you deduce this from the strong regularity lemma. Why is this enough to do the induced graph removal lemma? Well, you're going to use what's going on between UI and UJ to dictate what you do with the edges between VI and VJ. So if the edge density between UI and UJ is close to 0 or 1, you're going to delete all the edges or add all the edges. If the density is bounded away from 0 and 1, you don't have to do anything there. And that's what you'll do between VI and VJ. And because the densities between VI and VJ are typically close to the densities between UI and UJ, you actually haven't changed much of your graph. So that's how you would get the induced graph removal lemma from this corollary. And it turns out that this corollary, you can prove it without using the strong regularity lemma. So instead of a Wowser type bound, it can be proved with a tower type bound. And the tower height is currently polynomial in 1 over epsilon for this. That's necessary for this corollary, but it's unclear what should be the case for the induced graph removal lemma. So this corollary is enough not just for induced graph removal lemma, but for general testing hereditary properties. So this brings these Wowsers down to tower, still completely useless. I mean, you say this is constant time algorithms, but when your constant depends on a tower function of a constant, then it's not actually useful. But for a theoretical, theoretically, these are quite interesting, and it's totally unclear whether these bounds can be dramatically improved or not in the removal lemmas.
I mean, well, what if epsilon is like a third?
Yeah, so maybe for epsilon is a third, you might be able to come up with an ad hoc argument to work for there, but once you get something like epsilon is a tenth for some of these properties, you start seeing this enormous constants happen. Okay. Any questions about this? So how does the proof of that you get tower come from? So the proof of the strong regularity lemma was to take the usual regularity lemma and repeatedly use it, apply it. There's a weak regularity lemma of Duke, Lefman, and Rudel, which is not so different, but it's in the same vein as the regularity lemma of Fries and Cannon, and it gives you a single exponential bound. And you can repeatedly apply that regularity lemma and get a strong version of that and get a tower-type bound. And if you're careful with that, you can use it to prove this corollary and get better bounds for these graph property testing problems. Yes?
So, I remember, so at the moment you sort of call epsilon, which is independent of the graph you're actually testing for, right?
Yes.
But in practice, do you actually need to take some function of that graph, or as in sort of to be actually a useful test, is it?
Sorry, so you have a big graph,
yeah,
and you have a...
But the induced graph you're testing for, does that...
So your dependencies will be on both the epsilon and the thing you're testing for. Yeah.
The epsilon itself is usually taken to also to be a function of the number of edges or something.
Of the little graph? I don't know how people are doing this in practice now, because still with these sorts of things, it's tower type. So... yeah, you still get these sort of bad bounds here. Yeah.
By the way, to get this corollary from the strong regularity lemma, you need to take this function f to be 1x squared or something.
Yes. Yeah. So you take it to be 1 over some polynomial, and then yeah. When I talked about the bounds there, it to be more correct about it, it both depends on epsilon and f. Because of the, but the dependence on F is not very strong. So as long as F is at most even tower type, you still get Wowser type bounds. Once you get it F to be huge, then, or 1 over a huge function, then you run into issues. But so there's a pretty weak dependence on F there.
At least for small F.
For
at least for F, not too extreme.
Yes. Yeah. Right. Which is usually the case in these applications. Okay, now I'm going to switch to approximation algorithms, and the regularity lemma, if you apply it, can be very useful for various approximation problems. The problem is, the first question is, can the regularity lemma be made algorithmic? So many parts of the proof of it look algorithmic. There, that you can make a fast algorithm out of. There's one part that's problematic when you first look at it, and this part is when you have a pair of parts x and y, you'd like to determine if it's epsilon regular or not. So I give you two vertex subsets. These are parts of a partition. I ask you, is it epsilon regular? And if it's not epsilon regular, you want a pair of subsets which realize this. So you want to find an x prime, which is a subset of x, and a y prime, a subset of y, which show that it's not epsilon regular. Now, as stated, this is an NP-hard problem for a particular epsilon. But if you're allowed to change epsilon, if it's not epsilon regular, you just want to find a pair which shows that it's not epsilon prime regular for epsilon prime, which will depend on epsilon, then maybe there's some hope for this. So at first it looks like a serious problem, but you can make the regularity lemma algorithmic. And the way you do this is based on the idea that David Conlin had mentioned earlier in this Chungram-Wilson development on quasi-randomness in graphs, up to changing the error. Testing having the property that it's pseudo-random is equivalent to the C4 count being close to the random bound. So if you have these two subsets, x and y, of your graph, and you're trying to test whether it's, to see whether or not it's epsilon regular, just count the number of C4s where two vertices are in x and two vertices are in y. And if it's close to being, if it's close to being what you'd expect if the edges were random of the density going across, then it'll be epsilon regular for a different choice of epsilon, some epsilon prime depending on epsilon. Yes?
Just a question. Does the algorithmic version lose something in the height of the tower?
It's a polynomial change in epsilon, yeah. Later it's been, there's later work that's improved on this. Most recently, if a pair of parts is not epsilon regular, you can find a pair of subsets which realize it's not epsilon prime regular for any epsilon prime less than epsilon. So if you're, so if it, epsilon prime is 1 minus some little bit times epsilon, you can still do this now. This is recent work with Laszlo Miklos Lovas and Yufei Zhao. But in the traditional way, through this C4 count, you lose a power on epsilon. So you would just count the number of C4s going across. And if the density is too large, you can use the neighborhoods in a way to find two large subsets that show that the density is off between those two subsets. So you can end up finding an X prime and Y prime, which realize that it's not regular across the pair. So counting C4s can be done quickly. You would take two vertices from here and two vertices from here. That's a quartic algorithm. Time. So you just, you know, there's n choices on the order of n for each of these four things. You're counting C4s going across two vertices like this. You can speed up this algorithm. You just need to count for each pair here how many common neighbors there are and take that, choose two, pick the pairs of common neighbors and sum up over all pairs here. That's a cubic algorithm for doing it. And then you can notice along the lines of what David had said on Tuesday, you can use matrix multiplication and speed it up by noticing that the number of C4s you can, number of four circuits here is exactly the trace of some matrix multiplication. And you can use the fastest algorithm for matrix multiplication to get a speed up here. And the question was how fast can you make the algorithm? And it was sped up from from essentially matrix multiplication time down to n squared time by Kohayakawa, Riddle, and Tama. They had a very nice idea. Instead of looking at every pair here on this side and counting the number of common neighbors they have, you can put an explicit sparse expander graph down here and count just over the pairs in that expander graph. And that will give you a quadratic time algorithm. Quadratic in N, which is actually linear in the input size. How would you normally describe a graph? Well, you could look at its adjacency matrix as a simple way to describe a graph. You really need to look at essentially all the pairs to do that here. Okay. Why is this useful? Well, here's a basic algorithmic problem. You're given a graph on n vertices. How many cliques are there of order k in your graph? So you have n vertices. You want to know how many subsets of size k make a clique. A clique is a subset of vertices where every pair of vertices in size is adjacent. So you have these k vertices, and all k choose two pairs are edges. And you want to count the number of them in a graph on n vertices. Now, there's a trivial algorithm to count them. You just look at all the k subsets, look and see, do they form a clique? That's n choose k subsets you have to look at. That's like an n to the k time algorithm. That's very slow if k is not too small. For exact counting, it's not so far off from the best known. So you can use matrix multiplication in a clever way and improve the exponent from k to the matrix multiplication constant divided by 3 times k. So it's something like 0.8k, and that's what's best known for exact counting. In general, this is an NP-hard problem, there was a lot of work going into building on this, building on earlier work of Hastad, Zuckerman showed that it's NP-hard to approximate the size of the largest clique in a graph within a factor n to the 1 minus epsilon. So that implies that this problem is NP-hard. But it's really saying that it's quite hard to see what's going on in the graph. So I give you a graph on n vertices. And I tell you in this graph, one of two things is true. Either there's no clique of size larger than n to the epsilon over 2, or there's an enormous clique of size at least n to the 1 minus epsilon over 2. And I tell you, in polynomial time, I would like you to tell me whether or not it's the first or the second option. And unless p equals np, you can't do this. So it shows that certain questions here are quite difficult. Now, a natural question to look at is how fast can we approximate the count within some additive error? So in total, there could be all up to n choose k cliques, and this is on the order of n to the k, and you'd like to approximate the count within some additive error. And how would you do this? Well, there's a very simple randomized algorithm for this. So what is the randomized algorithm? You sample 10 over epsilon squared random k sets of vertices. Now, there's some count of cliques in your graph, and there's some density of k tuples that makes cliques. And if you sample at random k sets, 10 over epsilon squared k sets of vertices, your sample is going to have a binomial distribution around with your p-value being the density of k-cliques. So you're going to look at these random k-sets and count the density of them that are that form k-cliques. And with very good probability, it's likely close to the density of k-cliques in your entire graph. So from that, you can approximate the count of k-cliques in your graph. This doesn't give you with total certainty, though. It just tells you with 99% certainty. And there's certain things in life that that some people would like to know with absolute certainty. And the question of removing randomness is a big problem in complexity theory, and it's what a lot of around what Luca was talking about earlier. And so you'd like deterministic algorithms for this. You'd like to know with certainty. And to do this, you can use the graph regularity method. So if you want to approximate the number of k-cliques up to epsilon n to the k, you would apply the regularity lemma to your graph. So you would get a regularity partition. Here's your regularity partition. And for most k-tuples of parts, every pair between them is going to be epsilon regular. And so you can use the counting lemma, and you know the count of k-cliques between those k-parts is close to the count as if the graph was random between those pairs of parts. So if you wanted to count triangles, and you found three subsets, each pair of which are regular, then you can count the number of triangles up to some little error using just the densities between the pairs of parts. And there's only a small number, this tower type, but it only depends on epsilon, number of parts. And so you would do this over all k-tuples of parts. And there's only a small number of them that are not going to have the property that each pair of parts inside are regular. So using that, you can approximate the counts of k-cliques. The problem is that there's this dependency that comes out from the regularity method. So there's a dependency on epsilon. There's this constant in front, which is a tower type function. And the question is, can you improve on this? Because this is not actually useful in practice. So in the mid-90s, Duke, Leffman, and Rödl developed a new weak regularity at the time, lemma, which had only an exponential type dependence. And essentially following this idea, but with this weak regularity lemma, was able to prove a bound which is only, so n to the omega time, but the constant dependency was only exponential. Recently, with my
what
student,
omega?
What?
Omega. N to omega. Yeah.
N to the omega time. So that's matrix multiplication time.
And what is the omega?
Omega is a matrix multiplication constant. Right now it's 2.3, roughly 8 or so. And it's likely actually supposed to be 2, but the fastest we know to do is this. Now with the improvements by Kohayakawa, Rodel, and Tama, you can improve this to 2. So using that came after this. This now can be brought down to 2, not for matrix multiplication, but for this application because of the regularity ideas that go into it. In this recent work, we were able to look at the Fries-Kanon weak regularity lemma. And instead of using the Fries-Kanon partition, we were able to use those pairs of subsets you get in the Fries-Kanon weak regularity lemma. And so instead of getting an exponential number of parts in a partition, you need to only look at 1 over epsilon squared pairs of parts, and you can use that together with a counting lemma carefully and bring the epsilon out of the exponent down below. So you get a polynomial dependence on epsilon. So these are fast, pretty fast algorithms that rely on the ideas around regularity, but give you much better bounds. And as a corollary, suppose, for example, you want to count cliques of size 1,000 in a graph. So the natural thing would take you n to the 1,000 time to count it exactly, to approximate it, the count. So there's on the order, typically, if you took a dense graph at random, you'd have on the order of n to the 1,000 cliques there. For every graph on n vertices, you can count the number of cliques up to an additive n to the 1,000 minus 10 to the minus 6, which comes out of picking epsilon appropriately in the above bound. So that essentially cancels out n to some power, where it cancels out the k squared. And so you can do this in time n to the 2.4. So you can do fast algorithms to approximate counts with this polynomial type improvement. Are there any questions so far about this? So the key thing I wanted to show was that the regularity lemma and the ideas behind the regularity method have been very useful in these sorts of algorithmic applications. The big thing, though, is whether or not we can remove the regularity lemma altogether from applications.
Can I ask a question about
yes.
this? So yeah, how does 1,000 come into the complexity here?
You're wondering about the constant here, or?
No, well, it's partially that, but in general, I mean, what if you remove kn instead of?
I'm just plugging into this certain k, which is 1,000. And I picked n to be, I picked epsilon to be n to the minus 1 over k squared, so that this would become n squared. And then this is the dominant term of these two in that case. So I picked it in such a way that the 10 to the minus 6 is this case, is 10 to the 6 is k squared. And it's some little improvement one gets, but it's a polynomial, and we haven't seen this behavior yet for this type of problem. And k1000 is not important here in the sense that it could be any graph with 1,000 vertices. So the same counting lemma and ideas here around regularity still work in this for counting other things. You can also do induced counting too. Does that answer?
Yeah, I was just trying to remember, for example,
question.
If n is a million, then 1,000 is square root of that.
Yeah, so that's exactly where this million's coming from, this 10 to the 6.
Right, so then you're actually, I mean, in some sense it looks like Zuckerman is sort of contradictory in Zuckerman's thing, because you're actually approximating square root of n cleek in one graph. So I'm just trying to figure that out.
If you put like a 1 over n, if you put square root of n into k here, and you tried to have an epsilon that balanced it, you would end up getting square root of n minus 1 over n. And that part here is so small.
Yeah, I wasn't saying that's the right thing. I'm just trying to figure out.
Yeah. So it doesn't contradict it. So that was telling you whether there's one thing that's huge or not. And this is only going to be really useful for k up to something like, I think, root log n. So it's certainly only polylog where this becomes.
K1000 is pretty big, right?
That's true. So this hasn't been run in practice yet.
Humongous.
Yes, that's true. But I think people also are interested in some smaller values than 1,000. And so this is telling us some new information. You know, for k being 5 or 10 or something, this is also saying some things that we didn't know before.
Well, it's better with smaller values.
Right, yeah.
So, I mean, it's impressive you can do it up to 1,000 and something reasonable.
Yeah, I mean, when you have a minus 10 to the minus 6 here in the exponent, if you wanted to put in reasonable n, even if you put in 2 to the 10 to the 6 here, you're only getting a factor 2 out of this. And 2 to the 10 to the 6 is much larger than the number of particles in the universe. So it looks nice, but in terms of practical applications for 1,000, it's useless. Okay, so a major drawback of this regularity lemma is a tower type dependence. And there's now been an enormous number of applications in number theory, in extremal combinatorics, and algorithmic problems. So we'd like to find alternative proofs of the applications we have which avoid using the regularity lemma and give improved bounds. And we saw for some things that you can give some improvements, but in general we don't know how to do this. But this sort of problem has been a real big driving force in combinatorics and some related areas over the years. And there's been some powerful techniques which have solved number of long-standing problems in the area using these ideas. So one of them is a probabilistic technique called dependent random choice. And it turned out to be the right idea for many problems in extremal combinatorics and Graff-Ramsey theory. So many problems fell using this idea. There's a survey by Benny Sudikov and myself on this topic. So this has been a powerful technique, which has been used as an alternative to the regularity method. There's another strategy called the greedy embedding method, where you're trying to embed some subgraph, and you greedily embed things one at a time, and you carefully make sure that there's still room in your graph to continue. And if not, it tells you something went wrong in your graph, and then you can use that structure. So it's motivated by ideas around the regularity method. There's another idea which is helpful for embedding sparse spanning structures called the absorption method. And the biggest recent development using the absorption method, this is, Sam Reddy's been doing a lot of work on this technique and others, but the most recent thing was by Kuhn and Ostis, where they gave a new proof of the existence of designs and even more general results using an iterative absorption method. So basically, you want to embed some spanning structure in a graph. So you want to use up all the vertices, like find a Hamiltonian cycle or some other, or a disjoint collection of triangles that span the whole graph. And you set aside some nice structure that allows you to absorb problems at the end. Is the basic idea there. And then higher Fourier analysis has been very useful in applications in additive combinatorics. So Sam Reddy's theorem, instead of getting these enormous bounds that come from using regularity methods, you can use higher Fourier analysis and get constant tower height for bounds in Samradi's theorem. So there has been a lot of progress. Not all of the problems have we found applications for, but there's found new proofs that give better bounds. But for many of them, there has been significant progress. I want to finish by just mentioning a couple of applications of arithmetic regularity. So that was talked about yesterday by Fernando. Because there's been some recent progress on the bounds there. So Ben Greed developed this first regularity, arithmetic regularity lemma, and used it to prove two extensions of Roth's theorem. So the first is Green's arithmetic removal lemma, and that was proved yesterday by Fernando. He did it in fp to the n, or f2 to the n, actually. But the proof works in essentially the same way for fp to the n, so in vector spaces over a finite field. Green's proof actually works for all abelian groups. So if you have three subsets of an abelian group, and there's a few triples, ABC with A plus B plus C equals 0 going across, then you can delete a small number of elements and get rid of all the solutions. Now, to get it for all abelian groups, because you don't have these nice subspaces as you do in vector spaces, you have to develop Fourier analysis on Bohr sets, and that becomes more complicated, but can be done in the same way. A few years later, there was another proof of this by Kral, Serra, and Vina, which I think is simpler, and it's directly from the triangle removal lemma. So similar to how we saw Roth's theorem follows from the triangle removal lemma yesterday, you can prove this arithmetic removal lemma from the graph triangle removal lemma. And this was done, but this took about 5 years before people realized that it could be done. And it allows you to get rid of abelian in this. So you can prove a version of this for all groups. There's also the second application is another strengthening of Roth's theorem, which says that you can get a lot of arithmetic progressions with the same common difference for some common difference. So if you took a random subset of a group G of density alpha, the density of three-term progressions would be almost surely concentrated around alpha cubed. So the probability that all three elements are there in a three-term progression is alpha cubed. It's not true, though, that whenever you have a subset of density alpha, there will be at least that many three-term progressions. There are constructions. For example, if G was the cyclic group on n elements, there's this Barrand construction, which shows that, and you can blow that up, and which shows that you can find subsets of density alpha where the density of three-term arithmetic progressions is much smaller than alpha cubed. However, so what Green proved is that while the total number of three-term arithmetic progressions can be much smaller than the random bound, there is a non-zero D such that the density of three-term arithmetic progressions with common difference D in the set A is at least alpha Q minus epsilon. So you can get as close to what you want, as close to the random bound as you'd like in terms of the density for some common difference. Okay. So these are two applications of the regularity lemma, the arithmetic regularity lemma. And recently, for one of them, a polynomial bound was proved. And for the other, a tower type bound was proved. So they were proved to be tight. So for the arithmetic removal lemma, a polynomial bound, I should say that this is only in fp to the n. A polynomial bound turned out to be tight. And this turned out to be motivating a lot of work in arithmetic property testing. So there's been a lot of work around this problem of estimating the bound in the arithmetic removal lemma in F2 to the n, because it's a basic question in arithmetic property testing. And there, instead of the tower type bound that comes from the regularity approach, using the recent cap set theorem and a generalization called the multicolor sum free problem, building on all this recent development, and I think Tom Bloom's going to talk about that a bit more tomorrow, it turns out you can get a polynomial bound and in fact get the sharp exponent. And it turns out to be some strange constant. In F2 to the n, the exponent turns out to be this transcendental number, which is about 13.239. And in for when p is 3, it turns out to be about 13.901. And it's the solution to some optimization problem that comes up pretty naturally there. There's been a lot of exciting development, which Tom Bloom's going to talk about more tomorrow, which this builds on. And so this is recent joint work with Laszlo Miklós Lovász. Unfortunately, this whole approach, we currently don't know how to say anything in the cyclic group. So this works in the vector space Fp to the n, but we don't know how to do anything in the cyclic group z sub n. So here we get polynomial bounds. In the other application, recent work with Hoi Pham, we did this first in vector space. It was Hoi Pham and myself in vector spaces. And then in follow-up work with Yufei Zhao, we extended it to all abelian groups. It turns out that the bounds you get here are, in fact, tower type. And the tower is not polynomial in 1 over epsilon. The answer is logarithmic in 1 over epsilon. So there's both lower and upper bounds. The upper bound uses the idea behind the regularity proof. But it turns out that for this problem, it's more natural to look at the mean cube density. So when you use the arithmetic regularity proof, you're looking at the mean square density. For counting three-term progressions in Fp to the n, it turns out that you need to look at mean cube density. And at each step, you need to apply the weak regularity lemma and associated counting lemma. And you can use this and bring down the tower height to logarithmic. And then there's a construction which matches this sort of behavior. It's harder in abelian groups, again, because you don't have subspaces, and you need to do Fourier analysis on Bohr sets. So that's a recent result, which shows that regularity ideas are really necessary in certain applications. So this tower is really the same tower that you're getting in the regularity lemma. And this is the first application I know of a regularity lemma where the tower type bound is needed. I don't know any example of application of Samarati's regularity lemma for graphs where you actually need the tower type bound, but for the arithmetic regularity lemma, this is an application where you do really need the tower type dependency. Example of this, suppose instead of you just getting within epsilon, you wanted half the random bound. And this is an Fp to the n, and here p is going to be a prime that's at least 19. The upper bound still works. The lower bound has some issue for small values of p because of we want constructions as a part of a building block in this construction. You want large subsets of Fp to the n without three-term progressions. This is a building block in the proof. And it's not good enough for small values of p. But for p at least 19, if you want at least half the random bound, the answer is within an absolute constant of the tower height is within an absolute constant factor of log p times log log 1 over alpha. So for p fixed, this is a tower of height log log 1 over alpha. And in general, you can get a bound from these methods, which is essentially tight up to some absolute constant factor plus some error term that depends on p for the tower height. So we're seeing some places where these regularity lemmas are really necessary to our understanding of what the right bounds are. And with that, I'll finish. Thank you. Are there any questions?
I got it. Does this latter result have an analog for Zn?
Yeah, so the lower bound is actually going, it's going to be different. So the log 1 over alpha, this behavior, and the log p here, it comes from the bounds that we know for the cap set problem, or more generally for fp to the n. And both the lower and upper bounds you can use there to get the right behavior. If you're using, if in Zn, at each step you can use the Baron construction, which is better as a lower bound, and it's not going to be log anymore. It's something in between log and log. And the upper bound should probably be matching whatever the best answer is for Ross theorem. But then we've been talking about this with Yufei. You have to do Ross theorem on Bohr sets. And it's not clear if that's the same as Ross theorem on the integers, at least for the proof sort of technique. So we think everything, that the answer to this really comes from iterating the bounds in Ross theorem for whatever group you're looking in. But we don't know for sure because of these technical issues. That's a good question. I should mention, tomorrow, Yufei Zhao, for the last talk in the sequence, will talk around sparse regularity and how you can use that to show that the primes contain long arithmetic progressions. So this has been following up on the work of Green and Tao, which shows this, that you can get long arithmetic progressions in the primes. And he'll discuss the graph theoretic approach to this. Is there any last questions? Yes.
Presumably, there is no reduction from the popular difference problem to triangle removal. Otherwise, you would get a lower bound for triangle removal.
Yeah, I don't see any way.
But can there be a reduction to graph removal where the size of the graph can depend on epsilon?
I would be very interested in that. I don't know. I was hoping to find other applications of regularity where tower type is necessary in the graph setting. And this popular difference result, because when you're doing this arithmetic setting, things are regular with themselves, it becomes within subsets, it becomes somehow more natural. So it's unclear to me what the right thing should be in the graph setting, that if maybe in the graph setting there's no application where you actually need it, except for itself, essentially. I would love to see some application in the graph setting because it seems like a different behavior there. Okay, thank you.